What if you could have hundreds of levels for your game, but only one or two scenes? In this video, we're going to look at how we can use scriptable objects to store level data so we can have virtually infinite numbers of levels without virtually infinite scenes. Hey, Chris here from LlamAcademy. Here to help you.
Who? Me?
Yes, you. Make your game dev dream become a reality by helping you have both more dynamic and consistent levels in your game. As I was making this free and open source mini golf micro game, full project on GitHub, full game on itch, both are free. I wanted all of the levels to feel the same without having to maintain a bunch of different scenes. I'm not a big fan of the additive scene workflow. I feel like it leaves a lot of room for error and inconsistencies. And I wanted all the scenes to be the same lighting, the same camera setup, the same everything, except the actual mini golf level should be different. That way I could give the illusion of hundreds potentially of levels without having to maintain a bunch of different scenes. So I was looking for a different solution. A really quick overview of that is I'm primarily using a tile map to set up the level. And for each child object underneath that tile map, I'm saving the prefab path in the resources folder, along with the position, scale, and rotation, saving a list of those to a scriptable object, along with some extra data about how many putts do you have to get 3 stars, 2 stars, 1 star, or fail. And because just spawning objects that just appear out of nowhere isn't very fun, we're also going to take a look at how we can procedurally animate these in to make it feel a little bit more juicy. Let's check it out. You can see that this game only has 2 scenes, the main menu and the game scene. Regardless of which level we select to play, we always load this game scene. As we go to the next level, we actually just reload the same scene again. Which scene we're going to load is stored in this level data scriptable object. So you'll see we have all levels available here, 1 through 12, and our current level is level 2. Level 2 is a level scriptable object that has the world object positions and then how many strokes you can do to make different levels of par. You can extend this if you want to dynamically change the lighting or something like that, but we're going to keep it simple today. In our game scene, we have this script, the level spawner. In a future video, we're going to go through the level combiner, but you'll notice that it has a reference to that level data scriptable object, and so does the main menu. We've got some total animation time and animation speed to control this effect that you see right now. And those are the core critical components that we need to know about: the level data, this level spawner, and this level scriptable object. And just for completeness, if we look at the main menu, we'll see this main menu script has this level data SO. And whenever we click play and click on one of these, it overwrites this level so the next scene can pick it up. We'll take a look at that first. Here we are in the main menu. We've got this on level selected, which is what gets called whenever we tap on one of those UI things selected. Our level data, which is that serialized level data SO. We're setting that level to be whichever level scriptable object was selected. Then we just load that next game scene. And in that game scene, we have this level spawner that also has a reference to that same level data scriptable object. And this is where we're gonna really focus the core of our tutorial here. This script will, on awake, make sure that we have the core level set up how we want it. Like you have to have 4 pars, one for each of the possible outcomes where you get 3 stars, 2 stars, 1 star, or you fail. We need to have that level data and we need to have some objects to spawn. If we don't have any of those, then we're gonna assume it's poorly constructed and send you back to the main menu. So if you test your game, you should see this and fix it. We make sure that the ball is not gonna use gravity. We disable any colliders and then we set up the level. When we set up the level, all we're doing is finding the tile map, finding the grid, clearing it, meaning we're going to destroy all the children. This is actually a really important step in case there was accidentally anything left over in the scene. We want to iterate backwards from the last child in the tile map transform to the first one. If you go front to back like you normally do, i = 0 and go to the end, you're mutating the collection as you're iterating over it, which ends up causing problems. So doing it this way, we are certain that we're not going to mutate the collection while we're iterating over it and getting random objects left over. Coming back up to setup level, we're going to grab the total number of tiles we want to spawn in, set up the base delay to be the total animation time divided by the tile count, and we're going to set an index to be 0. We're going to get a list of prefab spawn data, which is what these world object positions are. We're making a new list so we don't mutate the data in that scriptable object. We're going to sort them. And by the way, I made this iComparable, which basically is measuring how far away from 000 they are. The square magnitude is going to tell us the square distance basically from 000. Because a position vector is describing how far away from zero we are, right? If we have x as 1, y and z as 0, that's 1 unit away from zero. If we've got x at 10, y at 10, z at 10, then we're very far away from zero compared to the other one. So square magnitude is going to tell us the length of the vector effectively, or the square length of the vector, some fancy math stuff that I ignored in college and now am using. So key lesson learned here is you are going to use it when you learned it in college. So coming back to our level spawner, once we've sorted these by distance from zero, we're just going to iterate over each of them. We're going to load it from resources. We're going to grab the spawn location to be the position from our prefab spawn data. And we're going to set the spawn location to be vector 3 up times the animate in curve. So we're just animating on the y axis from whatever this curve tells us it should do. Then we're going to instantiate this prefab at that spawn location with whatever rotation was provided in our prefab spawn data. And we're going to set the parent to be the tile map transform. We're then going to set the local scale to be vector 3, 0. So we're going to animate it up and we're going to scale it up. This is some procedural animation. You can choose whatever you'd like to do. This just looked cool to me. Then we're going to start our coroutine to animate in this instance, setting it to scale up to whatever scale is provided in our prefab spawn data, because it might not be 111. And we're going to do that base delay that we calculated a second ago from the total animation time divided by the tile count. And the animation in part, you can do whatever you want here. This is just what I chose to do. If you want the same effect, you can, of course, just copy paste this. That's cool. How it works is we take the target location to be the transform position plus vector 3 up. We're going to wait this delay that was passed in. And then we're going to iterate over a base 1 second, but that can be slowed down or sped up with the animation speed. So higher values of animation speed will make this go faster and be less than 1 second. And lower values will slow it down, making it take longer than 1 second. And we're just going to offset the position with the animation curve evaluated at that particular time. So in my case, it looks like this, where it starts at -1 and comes up to 0 following this kind of smooth curve. So it starts a little bit slow and then picks up speed over time. And it's very important for how this works that you go from 0 to 1 and that your ending Y position of this graph is 0. So you don't manipulate the offset at all. And we're just basically lerping the Y position and the scale at the same time. At the end of any coroutine-esque animation, I always make sure to set the position and scale to be exactly what the targets are. And then these things have animated in. Once we've animated in, we've got our start, which, by the way, if you didn't know this, you can make start a coroutine instead of returning void. So you can do things like yield return new wait for seconds. So we're going to wait for that whole animation time to complete plus 1 second. So we let the last tile finish its animation. Well, 1 times the animation speed. We'll wait one additional frame just to be safe. We're going to come in a future video to look at what the combiner does. So don't worry about that right now. We're going to invert what we did on awake, where we set the gravity of the rigid body on the ball to be false. We're going to set that to be true now. We're going to enable that collider as well. And we're going to enable the player controller. By the way, I'm using Rider, the best C-sharp IDE made by JetBrains. I've got a link in the description that'll get you 25% off an annual subscription to Rider with code LlamAcademy. Highly recommend you check this out. I've been using JetBrains products for over 10 years, and I just love their IDEs. Now, this next part I thought was really cool. Because on some levels, the ball can fly off the green or off the sand. It can fly out of bounds, basically, like this. We needed some way to detect that the ball had flown off the level and bring it back to the last place that we putt from. So how we're handling that is this level bounds game object. That's a collider. So once the ball exits this collider, it will reset the level and count as a stroke. Pretty cool, right? So we construct that from this level spawner on start. It's just a box collider, and we add this level bounds component and tell it to resize based on the tile map transform. So what does that do? All resize does is make sure we have a reference to the collider. We set it to be a trigger. We grab the bounds and we iterate over each child in the parent and say bounds.encapsulate the renderer bounds, which just progressively scales up the bounds so they contain, they encapsulate the child renderer bounds. And then I'm setting the minimum and maximum to be a little bit extra off to the side so the ball can go off to the side a little bit. These are arbitrary values. And that's why you see it doesn't exactly match this level. In fact, if we take this out and now we look at the level bounds, you'll see that it very closely matches the bounds of this level, right? Which wouldn't work well if we go launching. As soon as we go up off a little bit, it resets. It feels glitchy almost. So that's why we're adding this extra padding on the side. Eventually, it's still going to let the ball get out of bounds, but it's not so aggressively scaled. Then it's important that we reset the center and the size of the collider based on these bounds. Then on trigger exit, we're just raising an event saying the ball has exited the bounds and let whoever handles that handle it. I recently covered event buses three different ways: scriptable objects, static class like this, scriptable object code based, and scriptable object editor based. If you want to learn more about event buses and event architecture, check out that video. I've got a link in the description and a card on the screen right now. That's really the core concept of what we're doing here. On awake, we're going to set up the level to spawn a bunch of prefabs based on what was stored in the scriptable object with the provided position, rotation, and scale. Then we add some juice to animate in the level to make it look a little bit nicer and doesn't just pop in, using a simple procedural animation, moving the position and the scale in. And we can use whatever curve we'd like. We can do something totally wild like this, but I felt like with the scaling in effect, that didn't look quite as nice. But you can, of course, play with the curve, remove the scaling, do whatever you want to find out how it looks best for you. Being able to save and load level data at runtime is very important for a lot of variety of genres and games, especially in like RPGs and survival games. And while for this implementation, we're manually constructing each level is only taking a couple minutes to put together, and then we can save that and add new levels very quickly. You can also procedurally generate stuff, but we're not going to get into that today for sure. But the tile map does support procedurally generating different levels, and you can put together data and spawn them in procedurally. Again, not going into that today. I hope in this video you learned how you can very easily spawn in and juice up your spawning animations from saved level data in a scriptable object, and how you can pass data between scenes using scriptable objects. If you did get value out of this video, make sure you've liked and subscribed, share it out with a friend or someone who you think would also get value. That really helps me grow the channel and get this important information in front of more people. And if you want to show your support monetarily, you can check out the LlamAcademy merch store right here on YouTube. Get yourself some merch, like a shirt like this. You can check out the affiliate links down in the description for your Unity asset store or your Humble Bundle shopping. Both of those give me a very small percentage of the purchase price at no additional charge to you, and that helps out tremendously. If you're going to buy an asset or buy a bundle, you just click through that link. That helps me out a ton. You can, of course, also become a Patreon supporter or a YouTube member. Both of those will get your name up here at the screen at the end of every video. You'll get access to a private Discord server where you can ask me more personal questions, more in-depth questions, get priority responses on YouTube comments. And at the awesome tier and higher, you can get a shout out at the end of every video, like Ivan, Ifiopoulos, Perry, and Mustafa. And there's also all of these great supporters as well. Thank you all for your support. I am so incredibly grateful.